Christ's two natures, human and divine. The statement that the Word was made flesh must not be taken to imply that it had been turned into flesh or mixed up with it. What is implied is that the Word took from the Virgin's womb a human body to be a temple in which to dwell. He who was God's Son was made Son of Man, not by confusion of substance, but by unity of person. That is, he so joined and united his deity with the humanity he assumed, that each of the two natures retained its particular quality, and yet, Jesus Christ is not two distinct persons, but only one. An appropriate analogy suggesting something of this mystery may be found in man, who we know is made up of two elements, neither of which is so mixed with the other as not to retain its own quality. The soul is not the body, and the body is not the soul. Thus, we speak of the soul in particular terms which are not relevant to the body, and of the body in terms which are not relevant to the soul. We speak of man in terms which do not apply to either of the others separately. Finally, there are things peculiar to the soul which are transferred to the body, and conversely from the body to the soul. Even so, the person who is made up of these two substances is a single man, not a multiplicity. Such expressions indicate that there is one nature in man consisting of two associated elements, and that nevertheless there is a difference between these two. This is the way in which Scripture speaks about Jesus Christ. Sometimes it credits him with what can only apply to humanity, sometimes with what especially belongs to deity, sometimes with what relates to both natures combined rather than to one. Indeed, it so carefully expresses the union of Christ's two natures that it assigns to one what belongs to the other, a literary device called by the early fathers a transfer of properties. Having proved all these things by the sound witness of Scripture, it will be obvious that nothing I say is my own. What Jesus Christ said about himself, that he was before Abraham was created, does not at all refer to his humanity, for he did not become man until many centuries after Abraham's death. The fact that he is called the firstborn of every creature, who was before all and by whom all things subsist, does not apply to a man. Praises of this sort are only appropriate to deity. The fact that he is called the Father's servant, that he is said to have grown in age and in wisdom with God and man, that he confesses that he is less than the Father, seeks not his own glory, does not know when the last day will be, speaks not of himself, does not seek his own will, can be seen and touched, all of that goes with his humanity. But in that he is God, he is equal to the Father. He cannot be said in any way to grow. He does everything on his own account. Nothing is hidden from him. He is invisible and cannot be touched. There is thus a transfer of properties apparent in Paul's statement that God purchased this church by his blood, and that the Lord of glory was crucified. Of course, God does not have blood and does not suffer, but because Christ was true God and true man, was crucified and shed his blood for us, what was done in his humanity is, by an inaccurate yet reasonable figure of speech, transferred to his divine nature. A similar example occurs in John, who writes that God laid down his life for us. There, he makes over to the divine nature what strictly belongs to humanity. Moreover, when Christ declared, "No one has ascended into heaven except the Son of Man who is in heaven," he was not at the time present in heaven in the body, but because he was God and man, because of the unity of his two natures, he attributed to one what was proper to the other.